everyone. Welcome to Championship Wrestling. This is Vince McMahon here at ringside, along with wrestling's living legend, Bruno Sammartino, where this week we'll take a look at the man from the Orient who's doing exceedingly well for himself, Bruno Torquemada.
Just as dangerous as ever and still undefeated, Vince. What can you say? Who's going to stop him?
Also scheduled to join us in individual competition will be the Olympian and the Intercontinental Champion, Ken Patera.
And he's looking cockier than ever, tougher than ever, and he's on top of the world because he's the Intercontinental title. And Vince, I fear that he's going to hang on to the title for a long time to come.
The Samoans will join us to open up things in our first match in a tag team effort in a non-title event, I might add. And then from there, later on, we're going to be seeing Baron Mikel Cicluna challenged by Pedro Morales, and it's pick 'em time, Bruno Sammartino.
Pedro's my friend, and he's the former champion. He's one of the finest wrestlers in the world. But he's going to have a heck of a tough time with Big Baron Cicluna. He's so big and strong. I'll say that it's going to be Morales, but I doubt it if it'll be by a pin or submission.
Should be a very exciting match. We're going to have a lot of excitement for you this week as Championship Wrestling continues in just a few moments. The following wrestling exhibition requires discretionary viewer participation. With us now, oh no, Lou Albano moving out. Captain Louis Albano, along with the Samoans, Afa Sika, in a non-title event here, to take on El Olimpico and Mr. Olimpico's newly found tag team partner. Well, let's go to our ring announcer now.
This is Championship Wrestling, promoted by Phil Zatko, supervised by the State Athletic Commission, and the officials assigned, Chief Deputy Commissioner in charge, John Santoro, the doctor in attendance at ringside, Dr. John Solchak, the timekeeper at the bell, Mike Mittman, and the referees for this hour of wrestling, Dick Worley, Gilberto Roman, Dick Kroll, Billy Caputo, and my name is Jill McHugh. The opening contest, it is a non-title tag team match, and it is scheduled for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. Introducing in the corner to my left, from Mexico City, weighing 240 pounds, it is El Olimpico. And his partner from Puerto Rico, weighing 238 pounds, here is George Rustello. And their opponents at a combined weight of 614 pounds from the Isle of Samoa. Here are the tag team champions of the world, the Wild Samoans. And the manager, Captain Lou Albano.
Lou Albano, the manager of the tag team champions of the non-title event here to open up things this week on Championship Wrestling. We're set for the action to begin. Olimpico against Big Afa. Nice arm drag takedown by El Olimpico. He's quick. Olimpico with a lot of experience. His tag team partner, what do you know, Bruno, about George Rossello?
Not a heck of a lot, Vince. I know that he's been wrestling in places like Trinidad, Barbados, Santo Domingo, Puerto Rico. You know, I've heard of him in those spots, but as far as really much of a background as far as what he's done in those places, I really don't know too much about him.
Afa firing out an arrow with that left hand and belts Rosello. About the only way you can tell these Samoans apart. Afa's left-handed, Sika's right-handed. Ah, Lepico dropped to the canvas. Lepico, who certainly has...
Former Olympic champion, Olympico, and look at him. Looks like a piece of garbage to that, baby.
Mr. Albano, mistaken about the
not too much.
Olympic champion. Yes, you could say that again, Bruno, but Olympico has had a lot of success in the past, not having a heck of a luck right now.
You know, Olympico's a pretty fine wrestler, there's no question about that, but Vince, against these Samoans, I don't know just what he's going to be able to do. And as far as his partner that we were just talking about a second ago, we haven't seen him in the ring yet, so we really don't know how much help he can provide.
Well, from the looks of things, I don't think Olympico's tag team partner is going to do a heck of a lot. But then again, you can't judge the book by the cover. Sika slamming Olympico like a sack of potatoes.
I don't know if the Samoan was trying to unmask Olympico a second ago, and if he did, and for whatever the reason he wears a mask, if it should be because of some, you know, perhaps an accident from the past or whatever. But I don't think that, despite all that, he might look too bad with the Samoans in there.
By comparison, that is.
Of course.
Afa firing off.
That Rosella looks like he can't wait till he gets in that ring, but so far Olympico hasn't been able to tag him.
Here he goes. Here comes the tag. Let's see what he can do now. Front part of who? Oh my. Turn a rope. Oh, Sika with an elbow. Rosello not doing too much. Afa now. Double team effort.
This guy looks like a long stick, baby. Like a bamboo pole. You call that competition for a Samoan?
Guabanos, ooh, Rosello. Albano gets in a cheap shot.
Well, actually, Rosello tagged and he hardly got in the ring, and the Samoans really came down on him heavy, so we still haven't been able to see if he's got any clever moves or anything. I don't know.
I think he was listed by the ring announcer at 238 pounds, Bruno.
Doesn't look that heavy. Of course, he's very tall, so I don't know. You know, he certainly doesn't look 238 to me, but he must be, what, about 6'3"? He's what you might say is tall, and that's all.
So far, that's all.
Well, you know.
The voice, of course, of Lou Albano about ringside. Ooh, Sika taking wide open shots here against George Rosello.
The kid needs a blood transfusion. Look at him, he looks like he's dead.
That's a Samoan drop. Just bend the cover. There's not much of a cover there, but it's enough to defeat George Rosello. So lights out for the opposition of the Samoans. Olympico not exactly holding his own, and then when he tagged out to George Rosello, it was all over.
That's for sure.
It is a time, 6 minutes and 1 second, and the winners, the World Wrestling Federation's Tag Team Champions, the Samoans.
The Samoans victorious. Rosella and Olympico biting the dust. We shall return with our feature confrontation, Baron Mikel Cicluna, challenged by Pedro Morales.
The following bout is set for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. Introducing in the corner to my left, from the Isle of Malta, 265 pounds, Baron Mikel Cicluna. And his opponent, 234 pounds, from Culebra, Puerto Rico, Pedro Morales.
There's Pedro with one of his friends. Our feature confrontation should be a good one. Cicluna, big raw bone, 275-pounder. Pedro Morales' credentials speak for themselves. Morales with the fire, Cicluna with perhaps a size advantage, and we're ready for the action to begin. Him down. And Cicluna claims there was a pull of the tights. There was obviously no pull of the tights. Morales now hooking that elbow, and again takes him down in a similar fashion. Who has a very short temper, really letting him have it right back, Bruno.
Well, that's correct. He knows, Cicluna knows him well. And they used to have met in that ring before. So they know each other's style and everything else well. And then Morales knows how tough and mean Cicluna can be, and he'll retaliate. You know, Morales will not take too much from anybody. As Cicluna's finding out.
The hard way. Not to take anything away from the Baron. Well, yeah, he has been with the best and can mix it up with the best on any given occasion.
Oh, there's no question about it. There's no way that if Morales should be the victor in his ring, there's no way he's going to do it in any easy fashion. Cicluna's big, as you said earlier, 275 pounds of raw bone and muscle, and he has been in there against the toughest in the world. And there's no way anybody's going to go in that ring and dispose of Cicluna in any easy fashion. I guarantee you, when this bout is over, both Cicluna and Morales will have received their share of the hard blows.
And Cicluna with the armbar, working on the shoulder area. There are many escapes from this holder, are there not, Bruno?
Well, yes, there are right now, and I think we will see it pretty soon. Morales has got to come up on his feet. It's one way, beautiful, hooking his legs and taking him down. But what I thought he might have done was to come up on his feet and then maybe spin behind him with his other arm and get to wind up behind Cicluna and knock him on balance. But as you said, there's many different ways to escape from that particular predicament, and Morales just chose a very nice, clever way.
Yeah. Cicluna trying to find a measure of escape. Rig in the face, and Morales is hanging on to that hold. We can hear Cicluna laying him in, can't you, Bruno?
Boy, you can sure hear him, I'll tell you. He's hit him right in the back of the neck. And with those big hands, those big bony hands he has, that's got to hurt Morales. See what Morales is doing after his throat. He says, okay, wise guy. Beautiful switch into us, set out in a hammerlock here.
Morales in. Well, there, Cicluna sort of, I don't know how he escaped from that. Nevertheless, they're back to the standing position.
Right, and I got a feeling there's going to be a flying head scissor coming up.
All the way over. And takes it down. Through the rope, nice shoulder block. Pedro on the warpath. Put on the brakes. Will they get him? Yes, they get him. Pedro Morales, victorious over the big Baron, Baron Mikel Cicluna. Cicluna apparently hasn't had enough, but I suspect really down deep he has. Let's get the official time.
The time of the match, 4 minutes, 43 seconds, and your winner, Pedro Morales.
Pedro Morales, victorious if we can. We're gonna have a little interview with Mr. Morales. And Baron Mikel Cicluna on his way back to the dressing room. And now let's go to Bruno Sammartino and to Pedro Morales.
Ladies and gentlemen, with great pleasure, my good friend and a former Worldwide Wrestling Federation champion, my good buddy, Pedro Morales. Pedro, congratulations.
Thank you very much, amigo.
Hey, this Cicluna, he's, you know, you've known him a long time. You know his tactic. He's always a tough, tough customer. And I'll tell you something, Pedro, that was a fantastic win here for you.
Thank you very much. You know, Cicluna is a big fellow, 6'5", 300 pounds. And he's tough, Bruno, you know. You know him very well, and I know him. And believe me, you have to be very careful what you're doing with Cicluna and there, because he's a very tough guy.
Well, Pedro, there's no question about it. He's very, very tough, and that was a beautiful win for you. But Pete, as long as all the years I've known you, I have to say this because I really believe it. You are even to me, you look better, and you even look even in better shape today than even when you held that title, if that's possible. And I always admired you for keeping yourself in such peak condition at all time. How do you feel? Are you different body weight-wise? Are you still weighing the same, or any changes at all?
Well, Bruno, you know, I started jogging around a lot, you know, and about 3 months ago, I weighed around 250 pounds, you know, and I said, I better take care of myself, because I always thinking about the Worldwide Wrestling Federation, you know, Bruno. I was champion some time back, and I'd like to have another crack. That's the reason I training, especially, you know. But like I say, I be running and lifting a little weight and swimming a lot, and believe me, I feel great, and I would love to someday have a top opponent. Like, don't get me wrong, Cicluna is one of the toughest men around, but I would like to have a crack of like Larry Zbyszko and La Patera, you know, again, and someday, I don't want the fan misunderstand me, but I want to show the fan what can I do in that ring.
Well, Pedro, I'll tell you something. With what you got going for you, I think that there's no doubt that you're going to get right back to the top. And I, for one, my friend, I would like to see it, because I don't know of anybody who deserves it more than you. And I, for one, would like to wish you nothing but the best in the future.
Thank you very much, Bruno. Okay. And please say something from me, from Larry Zbyszko, please.
I will. Ladies and gentlemen, the former heavyweight wrestling champion, Pedro Morales. And now back to you, Vince.
Thank you very much, Bruno Sammartino and Pedro Morales.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, this next contest is a special bout. It is set for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. Introducing in the corner to my left, from Columbus, Ohio, weighing 240 pounds. Sullivan from Kansas City, weighing 250 pounds. This is one of the greatest wrestlers in the world today. Ladies and gentlemen, presenting the NWA World Heavyweight Champion, Harley Race.
Harley Race. Just about ready to take on Frank Williams here. Harley Race, we certainly await your comments, Bruno, on the skills of Harley Race, but right now we're set for the action to commence. Harley Race in control. And as we see, that's one of the things, Bruno, that Harley Race does perhaps better than anyone, drive that knee down into the forehead area.
Well, that among other things, when it comes to pulling certain tricks in that ring that that can do an opponent in, he's truly an expert. He's probably better than anybody at that. And well, this is a premier wrestler. He knows his wrestling. Unfortunately, in my opinion, at least for a title holder that he is, I'd like to see a title holder to set an example for what for our sport. Here comes a suplex, by the way, and he should not be a rule breaker. And Harley Race happens to be one of the sharper of the rule breakers. I say sharper because he has a certain way of doing it and getting away with it because he's very clever and very quick in doing it. But as far as success, he's one of the most successful wrestlers around today. He wrestles everywhere, and his record is pretty doggone phenomenal.
Yes, and Frank Williams, a moment ago, doing quite well for himself, but once again finds himself in a bit of trouble. Again, there, Harley Race driving a knee into the facial area. A cover and a kick out by Williams. Race really whipping Frank Williams to the buckle, now to the ropes, heads off, and missed. Williams either fell to the side or alertly moved to the side. He's going nowhere now, I don't believe, though. Harley Race with a devastating suplex. The cover, I suspect he'll get him. Yes, indeed. Harley Race defeating Frank Williams here before the capacity crowd. Let's go up and get the official time, if we may.
It is time, 2 minutes and 34 seconds. The winner, the NWA World Heavyweight Champion, Harley Race.
Harley Race in the non-title match successfully defeating Frank Williams. Williams proving to be hardly any competition at all. Let's go now to some slow motion action we saw there in the latter stages. Here, Bruno.
Well, I think this is where I believe we're going to see him get Williams with the suplex. And as we see here, he scoops him, shoots him up in the air, takes his good old time. Race is strong. He'll get you up there. He'll really take his time. And then when he brings you down, he brings you down full force. And of course, he always beats his opponent with it.
Harley Race victorious. We shall return as we continue with more pro wrestling action in just a moment.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, the next contest is the one fall with a 10-minute time limit. Introducing in the corner to my right from Dawson, Georgia, weighing 240 pounds, it is Charlie Brown. And his opponent is just coming down the aisle, is being led into the ring by his manager, the Grand Wizard of Wrestling. And from Portland, Oregon, weighing 265 pounds, ladies and gentlemen, here is the Intercontinental Heavyweight Champion, Ken Patera.
Charlie Brown against Ken Patera. We want Backlund goes up the chat. Ken Patera, the former Olympian. He is undoubtedly an extraordinary athlete, a gifted athlete. The bell rings, but it'll take a while, I suspect, before Ken Patera is ready. Whispering into the ear of Ken Patera a moment ago. Again, you can hear the chant, we want Backlund. That is Ken Patera's way of objecting to the chant of the fans.
Bothers him, doesn't it, Vince? People keep chanting Patterson and Patera seems to be bothered by it, and I'm afraid that this will bring anger on him, that Brown will pay the price for it.
Already, Brown up in the air. Ooh, my. You're looking at the first man in history to military press over 500 pounds. Brown sort of halfway kicking out, but Patera could have pinned him if he wanted to, Bruno.
I think that Patera, and I'm not trying to pick on poor Charlie Brown because he's a very nice fella, but I think that Patera could end this bout just any time he felt like it. He is so powerful just right now with his front face lock, with the immense power that Patera has. If he wanted to, he could put enough juice there to make Brown either quit or make him pass out. But he wants to have fun. He wants to torture him a bit. He wants to torture him and keep working out, so to speak. He'd like to have a light workout. And when he's ready, he'll put Brown away.
Patera with a sharp right hand. And certainly we neglected to mention at the outset this week that scheduled to be with us later on will be Mr. USA, Tony Atlas.
Hey, Tony Atlas always provides you a lot of excitement at ring, Vince. And I think fans are always thrilled just to see the man, not only the great physique, but his great talents in the ring.
You know, Bruno, those who don't lift weights just really can't appreciate the feat that Ken Patera did. He's done so many of them, but making reference to that, the world record lift of his, the 500 pounds, the first man in history to military press 500 pounds. It's really tough for the average person to appreciate just what that means.
That's very, very true. And being one who, you know, I myself have competed in Olympic lifting and powerlifting.
I might add, still hold records that no one has beaten.
But when it comes to overhead lifting like the military press, 500 pounds, I remember in the very early 60s, was something that nobody believed it possible for a human being ever to press over 500 pounds. And this is the man who first did it, Campagnaro. He did a 507 pounds military press, which, as I said, it was just a feat that just it wasn't believed it would come about. No question about it. You can hate the man. I certainly don't appreciate his tactics in that ring, but he is just a super phenomenal athlete. Not only that, Vince, but he still holds many of the world records. He still holds all the Pan American records, a lot of the world records. This guy, and here comes the end of Charlie Brown right now.
Yes, indeed, the swinging full Nelson, Ken Patera's specialty. And he claps those arms down on it. It's curtains, no doubt. Finally letting Charlie Brown go. If Ken Patera will grant us one. Before we do that, let's get the official time.
It is the time, 4 minutes and 31 seconds, and the winner, the Intercontinental Heavyweight Champion, Ken Patera.
Ken Patera and the Grand Wizard victorious one more time in a non-title event here. Let's go back now and take a look at slow motion action if we still have it. Ken Patera, here we go. Put that swinging full Nelson. And this is the hold that so many people fear because it could be applied only by a Ken Patera. Patera with unbelievable strength and Charlie Brown in the clutches of Ken Patera. If we may, let's go now to Bruno Sammartino and company.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Intercontinental Champion and his manager, the Grand Wizard of Wrestling. Let me ask you a question. It seems as though when you guys were in a ring and the people were screaming, just as they are now, chanting, "We want Patterson." It seems as though it bothered your man quite a bit. And in fact, he came out of the ring threatening perhaps to leave or whatever he was threatening. And then when he did start the match, it looks like he took all his frustrations out on Charlie Brown. Does it bother him so much that people perhaps are still questioning and resenting in the fashion that Patera won the title?
Well, Bruno, I don't think it's as much that as it is Ken and I are appalled that this many people in this arena could all have such bad taste, such low class taste, to even think of Pat Patterson in the same breath with the greatness of the Pan Am, the Olympic Game champion. It's kind of like comparing hamburger to filet mignon. That's what upsets us.
Okay, it upsets you, but let me ask you the same question I just asked the Wizard. You seemed very bothered the fact that the people are chanting Patterson's name and still showing their kind of not approval of the way that you beat Patterson. Does it bother you much?
No, you know, I've always had a motto and I've lived by it when I won the world championships, when I won 4 gold medals in the Pan American Games, when I represented this country in the Olympic Games. That motto is, win if you can, lose if you must, but always cheat. You following that, Bruno? That's why I don't take the mic away. That's why the people are upset. Patterson got just what he was asking for because he's the one that accepted my challenge for the Intercontinental Belt. And I beat him right in the middle of the ring in Madison Square Garden. I beat him. I beat him until he was humiliated and embarrassed.
Well, of course, Patterson will take issue on that. But Patterson, when he held that title, he defended against just about all challenges. Now we have people like Morales, there's Atlas, there's so many great wrestlers here right now, and they would like to have a crack at that title. What is their chances? Are they going to get a crack at your title?
Hey, anybody that puts their name on the dotted line, whether it's Tony Atlas, Morales, Patterson, once again, Putski, maybe yourself. I know that you're having a little problem with the young man that was your protege by the name of Larry Zbyszko. I don't know if you're going to come out on the heavy end of that or not. Maybe you'll come on the bottom end, who knows? But if you do come out on the bottom end, you will not be in line to wrestle Mayburn.
Well,
I'm not trying to embarrass you.
You're not embarrassing me a bit, and I don't intend to get into any discussions with my own personal issues with anybody else. The point is that there are these people in line. You say that all they have to do is sign the dotted line. It's funny because I've spoken to some of these fellas, and they have from what I understand, they have even met with you. Their attorneys have met with you, Grand Wizard. Bruno, and so far, they are still waiting for an answer.
Bruno, the men that you talk to are men that can't sign their name to a contract.
The men I'm talking to are very honorable men.
This is a fighting champion. I don't care who they are. You heard it from Ken. Come on out of the woodwork, Tony Atlas. Come on, Putski. Come on, Morales. And we invite you two or anybody else.
Thank you very much. Back to you, Vince.
Thank you very much, Bruno Sammartino. We shall return, ladies and gentlemen, with Tort Kamata, Tony Atlas, and a whole lot more.
Ladies and gentlemen, the next contest, scheduled for one fall with a 10-minute time limit, introducing in the corner to my right from Millbrook, New York, weighing 260 pounds, here is Frank Savage. And his opponent from Tokyo, Japan, weighing 315 pounds, Tor Kamata.
Ring announcer almost took his life in his own hands there as Tor Kamata was going to work on Frank Savage before the match actually had begun. The bell has rung officially. The match is underway. Frank Savage has really yet to do anything at all, Bruno. He's been caught before the match began. That's Tor Kamata's style, as you brought out a couple of weeks ago. It seems to me that these young fellows would read the book on your opponents and studying them more and know that that is really vintage Tor Kamata. That's what he does.
Savage got it even worse because he got hit with those wooden, whatever they call those kind of shoes that they use. And he got caught with that in the back of the head, driving him outside the ring. And then being driven against that post. And there's no way Savage just has not had any kind of a chance at all to get on his feet and fight back against Kamata. But again, as you pointed out, Vince, they know that this extremely vicious man, you think that they would study him and be, you know, and be a little more prepared. Oh, and here comes that that kick right underneath the chin.
Another thrust, and Kamata again with another karate thrust. Kamata is not giving Frank Savage one chance.
None whatsoever. And look what he's doing right now, for goodness sakes. Well, perhaps if Savage will ever have the opportunity to wrestle Kamata again, he will not make that mistake of turning his head from him or his back to him. You got to, from the time you enter the ring, you got to keep your eye on this guy, because it's a known fact that he makes a habit of an attacking opponent prior to the bell ringing.
A knee of Savage caught Kamata off guard, I think. The right hand doesn't do a heck of a lot, I don't believe. You really can't tell.
Savage is so hurt right now that even those fists and even his knees there don't really have that much authority behind them.
Savage, a moment ago, could not haul the big 300-pounder out of the corner.
He's been weakened tremendously because he was just abused from the time that the bell, before the bell rang, actually, to this point. And here we go again. When you take a shellacking like Savage took from the very beginning, very seldom does one have the recuperative powers to actually come back and be do of any kind of a serious threatening to an opponent, especially of the caliber of Tor Kamata.
Off the rope now, Kamata lets him have it. Kamata off the rope again. Oh my. It is all over. So Toro Kamada really put the finishing touches on Frank Savage. Savage stood no chance at all. And Kamada, well, thus far here on Championship Wrestling, continues with his undefeated streak.
It is a time, 3 minutes and 36 seconds, and the winner, Torquemada.
Torquemada with a servile bow there a bit. Let's go back and take a look at some slow motion action, Bruno. Kamada and his opponent, Frank Savage.
Well, here he whips him to the ropes. This is where it becomes with that karate kick. And we see it, it lands right in the throat area. There it goes. Donnie went, and from this, he gives him a big splash from the ropes as he runs against the ropes, coming with all that weight of his. And that's it. Savage was done. I mean, he didn't even have to give him the splash. He was just with the kick, he was finished.
But the velocity of that coming down at the speed of gravity is something else again. Torquemada, 315-pounder, crushing his opponent, Frank Savage. We shall return, ladies and gentlemen, as we continue with undoubtedly one of the most popular and one of the most capable athletes to ever grace the squared circle, making reference to Mr. USA, Tony Atlas. Tony Atlas will be with us shortly, meeting individual competition. So we shall be back with Mr. Atlas as we continue in just a moment.
Our ladies and gentlemen, the next contest is scheduled for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. Introducing in the corner to my left, making his first appearance in this arena from Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, weighing 235 pounds, here is Ron Shaw. And his opponent in the corner to my right, from Roanoke, Virginia, weighing 250 pounds, here is Mr. USA, Tony Atlas.
Tony Atlas squaring off against the newcomer Ron Shaw from Philadelphia. Should be an interesting match. We'll see what Mr. Shaw can do against Mr. USA. Here we go. Atlas trying to break it. Well, he is breaking it. And look at this. Tony's having a good time in here at the moment.
I don't understand Shaw's idea of even attempting to fool Nelson, the likes of Tony Atlas. Here he is, Atlas, with that immense power and size. I wonder, really, was he testing himself or Atlas in thinking that perhaps he could hold him? That didn't make no sense at all to me. Neither does this, actually. Atlas chose to switch on him into a hammerlock, but from that overhead wrist lock, Atlas could have easily powered right out of it.
Atlas maneuvering Shaw against the rope.
He's listed at 230-some pounds, this Shaw. Now, to me, he looks a lot heavier than that, Vince. He's very tall, and he's heavy-looking to me.
In the program, I think he was listed at 255 pounds, but the ring announcer, I believe, said 235. Atlas now off the rope, jumps right over and drop kicks him. Oh, my, he got him right in the chest.
I showed the quickness of Tony Atlas, leapfrogged right over Shaw and came right back with a big high drop kick, sending Shaw sprawling.
Atlas now back to the corner and forearm smashed by Mr. Shaw, done with quite a bit of authority. Again, another one. Shaw with Atlas, able to bowl him over.
Yes, Atlas tried to switch him around, I think. Atlas with a right hand sticking in the midsection, another one. Atlas now with Shaw in the middle of the ring, scoops him up, slams him. Atlas on the ropes, what's gonna happen now? Oh my, headbutt, that's what happens. Atlas, whoa, crushing, two, it's over. Tony Atlas feels good. He looks good. Let's get the official time.
Here is the time, 3 minutes and 1 second, and the winner, Mr. USA, Tony Atlas.
Tony Atlas victorious. We hope to have him back here with us next week. Surely scheduled back with us, Pedro Morales, as Pedro Morales will be challenged by Johnny Rods. We'll have that match and a lot of excitement, I'm sure, for you next week here on Championship Wrestling. So until then, this is Vince McMahon, along with wrestling's living legend, Bruno Sammartino, saying so long from ringside.